I think those are my most productive days. We moved from a totally unhealthy diet to a very, very healthy diet. So we've got to look at technology as a tool.
Welcome to Great Principles. I am Seema Choria. We have a very, very special guest today on our show who, in spite of having reached to the epitome of success, has kept himself grounded with a strong conviction that learning is a lifelong process. Therefore, it's not surprising that in spite of running three schools in three different cities, he has kept his designation as Chief Learner and Director of Delhi Public Schools in Varanasi, Nasik, and Lava, Nagpur. Mr. Siddharth Rajgriha did his master's degree from the University of Strathclyde in Business Management and has also done specialized courses on leading schools and leading people from Harvard Business School Online. Being a strong believer and advocate for the development of emotional, social, and ethical intelligence in children, he completed the C-Learning course from Emory University in order to equip himself with the tools he needs as an educator to foster the development of his students and himself. It's an honor and great privilege to welcome to our show Mr. Siddharth Rajgriha, Chief Learner and Director, DPS, that is Delhi Public School, Varanasi, Nasik, and Lava, Nagpur. Welcome to Great Principles, sir.
Thank you, ma'am, and I'm delighted to be here, delighted to be a part of this show.
It's an honor, sir. So, sir, you know, Siddharth, sir, it is said that a person's childhood play a very, very vital role in our career choices. So we would like to know something about your childhood, your school life, and of course, your academic career.
I've been into various schools. As a child, I was a part of various schools. I was, I was brought up in Varanasi. And then I went on to study at the Chinmay International Residential School in Coimbatore. And I was an avid sportsman, a jack of all trades, went into all sorts of sports and, you know, did pretty well at each of them. When I was around 10th grade, my father got into school administration. And that was when my interest towards education really sparked, you know. And I was always a person who was very creative and who got a lot of ideas, you know. Never implemented any of these ideas, but every other day I would get a new idea, you know, especially in my engineering years or other, you know. I would get a new business idea and I would trouble and bog my friends and, you know, even my family members about it. So even, you know, when my father started being into school administration, every other day in my conversations with him, I would, you know, share that because I was into school, I was in, I think, 11th grade at that time. I would always share with him that, you know, why don't you do this? Why don't you try this out? And, you know, I would give him those ideas, but all in vain, you know, he always shared with me that this is not practical and this is not applicable. And I think somewhere that urge really made me look at, being a school leader and implementing some of those stupid or creative ideas, whatever you could say. And when I actually got into school administration, I realized that how some of them were so naive and unthoughtful. And, you know, but yes, that is where the seed was planted. And that is how I got into school education.
All right, so we have a very creative and a sports person here who has, like, you know, coming, bringing out some new innovations in education.
Right, absolutely. That is my, I would absolutely coin that, and I would, that's my area of interest totally.
So it's great to know your early days, sir. So now, given the scenario of COVID, you know, it's a time of uncertainty, stress, staying at home and adjusting to the home environment, sir. So during this time, what strength have you found in yourself?
So Seema ma'am, I felt, you know, that, you know, this is a the the early days of the COVID were really troubling because, you know, there was a very thin line between professional work and the house front, and everything was operating from the house, and there was no bifurcation between the two, right? So if you're sitting at home, and if you know, I'm doing my office work, but if my child is there and he or she needs help, then I'm attending that in between those, you know, or maybe ending the office work beforehand to attend to that, you know. So I think that was a very, very thin line that was there in the beginning, in the first few months of the COVID when the pandemic hit. But I think all of us have really emerged out of that. I've found, like for me, I think I've found that, you know, on the days when I have a fixed schedule, when I have a fixed plan, and I know that, okay, what am I looking for the next couple of days, I think those are my most productive days. And on the days when I have a flexible schedule, sometimes I love those days because then I get to read a lot and I get to, you know, explore the content areas which I'm eager to know, learn more about. But sometimes, you know, there are often those days as well when they're not planned enough. I sometimes tend to, you know, waste those days. So, or maybe, you know, do not utilize that time as fruitful as I might have utilized if it was, you know, totally packed. So I have really seen that planning your day well, and especially using the technology to plan your day well, has been very, very, you know, fruitful for me. And also, you know, throughout the pandemic, I would say I've really utilized the power of meditation, mindfulness. I'm a avid practitioner of mindfulness. I sit down for half an hour, 1 hour meditation. I try and sit down for a half an hour, 1 hour meditation every day. And I found that has, you know, brought in a lot of calmness to me, that has brought in a lot of straightforward thinking in these turbulent times for me. I try to practice regularly a lot of yoga, practices, and have a healthy diet. I've really over the pandemic, you know, it's something that really happened good for me is I've really to work on my diet, and I've really moved from a totally unhealthy diet to a very, very healthy diet. So that's really helped me through the pandemic. Yes.
So pandemic made you a better version of yourself. It improved your diet. It taught you mindfulness and helped you to meditate.
I was into meditation and mindfulness before that. But yes, the diet happened through the pandemic. The diet did happen through the pandemic.
Being all the hotels and all, everything closed, we automatically
Yes, and I, you know, actually what I'll just share, what actually happened was I, in the early days of the pandemic, I developed a severe skin allergy. And because of the allergy, I had to look within, and because I had taken a lot of medication and none of it worked really. So because of that, I wasn't able to walk for about 15, 20 days. Now, because there was no other option that I had tried allopathy, I was on homeopathic medicines, but it wasn't working. So that was when I had to, you know, figure out that, okay, there's something wrong with my diet that is not helping, and that is, you know, causing this to become irritant regularly. And that's how I had to figure out and, you know, chuck out one unhealthy stuff from my diet. And finally, I had a nice, so I'm a lot on veggies, a lot on juices now. So I think that's really helping me.
Wonderful. So like pandemic transformed education, it transformed sir's diet also. Great. So going ahead, sir, now we would like to ask you about, you know, the Delhi Public School, the DPS, it's a brand. What is your opinion about this brand school, and what is the philosophy of the school, how it positioned itself as a unique school of the country?
So, you know, DPS, the first DPS started in the early years of 1941. And DPS is a legacy school. DPS, brings along with it a lot of experience into the teaching learning process. DPS has taught us, you know, that how a legacy is actually made and how year on year you can deliver quality education. I've always felt that service before self, the motto of the school, has always played a pivotal role in whatever we've done. You know, we've always looked at the child as our center of effort in whatever we've done. We've always looked at providing the best quality, putting forward the best quality step for the children. And I think the pandemic again brought, all of us at the school, at our three campuses, especially, I would say that all the teaching faculty and all the admin people as well, really lived up to this motto of service before self. They put themselves out there in a lot of difficult times and made sure that the learning for the children was not hampered. And I feel that, without this as being our core motto and the value that we live for at Delhi Public Schools, I think it would have been really difficult if we did not have this sort of a culture wherein, we have to, we all believe and there's a shared understanding that all of us together have to, before our needs, we've got to put the needs of the children, we've got to put the needs of the families that we are serving, we've got to put their needs before what we require. And I think that that one belief, that one thought really made all of us at Delhi Public Schools work tirelessly, in the first, I would say, first 3-4 months of when the pandemic hit, because it was a big learning curve. It was a big learning curve for everybody. And I'm really, really happy with the kind of efforts the teachers put and the kind of hours they put. They were totally dedicated with the work. And today, all those efforts that we had put that day, those first days, and even regularly, we've never stopped learning, right? So those are shown today in the way children are learning, in the way children are sticking to our online classes, the attendance that we can see, the responses that we get from parents. It's really heartwarming. And I'm sure, all the teachers are also appreciating their own efforts that they've put in, they had to really unlearn and relearn overnight. So I think that was a tremendous job. It was, I believe only a resilient organization can put something of that sort. And we were able to do that. And hats off to our teachers to be able to, being so resilient in very, very difficult times. We've also had cases that there's someone whose family members is down with COVID and maybe in the next room, and still the teacher is on the online class and putting in those hours. So hats off to the teaching community, I think, across the country.
Absolutely, sir. Pandemic actually made us realize that there is one more unsung hero, and that is a teacher. And often we forget to, pay them the tribute for the hard work they put in.
Right. And, the pandemic really opened up the entire classroom was in front of everybody. So, the teacher had to really reinvent himself, because they were never YouTubers, or they were never people who could make videos. They were never taught that skill, right? They had to learn that skill, and so it was a very challenging time in the beginning.
Yeah, and we are really seeing some very creative stuff coming up from teachers these days, and it's really like marvels to see. Oh my God, we never looked at this side of our teachers ever. So likewise, technology has given that edge to teachers today. I would like to ask you here that if we, have a focus on technology in school curriculum, how can we build the next generation of future entrepreneurs of the country?
So I would say, Seemaji, that the focus shouldn't be on technology. The focus shouldn't be on technology. Jaise ki agar mujhe aapse, if I have to make a good positive relationship with you, we are using this Zoom call to build that relationship, right? But to make that relationship, this Zoom technology is only an enabler, right? But the way we communicate with each other, the conversations we have, the experiences we share, that is what will actually make our relationship go in a positive direction, right? So that is the difference. That is the exact difference. So we've got to look at technology as a tool, and just as a tool, right? We cannot look that, okay, technology will take the learning forward. No, it cannot. Technology is only as good as the teacher who's handling the technology. Like a car is only as good as the driver, right? If you put in a lame driver behind a car, he is going to go and crash the car. So technology is very important, very relevant in these times, but we have to keep in mind that it is not the hero in the classroom. The hero in the classroom is the teacher, and the technology is only a toolbox that this hero is carrying, which is enabling him to make sure that we are having better learning for the students. Now, what is actually going to, how technology is actually going to enhance the entrepreneurial skills of the students is, now with the use of technology, what is possible is we can reach out to every learner. Earlier, when we had, say, 35, 36 children or maybe 40 children in a classroom, it was possible, but was difficult that the teacher kept track of, okay, every child, that, okay, what was every child doing? Where is that child in this learning journey? If I'm teaching long division method, wo bachcha kahan par hai us journey mein? And where is Arnav doing? Where is Yamini doing? What is Sarika doing? It was very difficult for the teacher to keep track of every child. The teacher did have a track, but it was in his or her head, right? So, but it was very, very reasonable to miss out on one or two children who were not coming in front, jo piche chup karke baithe rehte the, wouldn't submit their notebooks in time. It was very possible that, the teacher would miss out on those things. Now, effective use of technology, it is not possible that the teacher misses out, because now everything, technology is helping us in the documentation process. If you are using the data that a lot of these applications like Desmos or GeoGebra, a lot of these applications, when they give the data, or maybe Kahoot, there are various tools, right? So a lot of these tools, the way they give data to the teacher really tells the teacher, okay, these two children in your class are not performing, or this particular area of long division, no child has understood. Every child can understand two number division, but no child has understood four number division. Right. So that sort of data is now relevant and available at a fingertip. Right. So that is available for the teacher. So now the teacher, while taking a class, can just open that data and see the graphical analysis of that, and then use that analysis to cater to the needs of the students. Now, what technology has also done is allowed us to differentiate lessons. So, for example, if I'm teaching fractions, okay, and I see that, okay, Arnav is lacking behind, right? And I know with my prior knowledge about Arnav that, okay, Arnav is interested in boxing, or Arnav is interested in cricket. So now, to pull Arnav up, I will give him a slightly different content than the rest of the students by giving him a question of fractions, which is linked with cricket, which will talk about Sachin Tendulkar or MS Dhoni or Virat Kohli. Right. So then Arnav is more eager to learn, to stick, come and put in more effort to learn that content or apply his mind to that content. So that is how technology is really enabling us as teachers to bring about this change and make sure that we touch every child. Make sure that we touch every child. Plus, technology is also allowing us to given a lot of creativity in the classroom. So just I'll share with you, I think this was possible earlier as well, when we could, you know, it's all about the way we question, right? So the kind of questions we pose, I think it is that is how it really helps them develop that entrepreneurial mindset, right? So so maybe, you know, putting up a question like, so maybe in an SST class, putting up a question like, if they're talking about Mohenjo-daro or, those sort of areas, and say if Arvind Kejriwal was the administrator at that time, how would he solve that issue? You know, I'm just, so that's a very creative thought process. That's a very creative question. That is a situation that never existed, right? So it's really important to ask these sort of questions to children, because when children will be adults, when children will get into their work life, they will have situations which do not exist today. They will have the problem of climate change, which we don't know how to solve. So they will need to solve those problems in order to survive, in order to be, you know, a sustainable community. So we need to give them, today we need to give them those problems which have not been solved, so that they develop that creative mindset of thought, you know, thinking to solve these problems. And, you know, that in turn will give them this mindset of getting into entrepreneurship and thinking big and thinking on their own.
Absolutely, sir. Technology is definitely an enabler and is never going to replace a teacher. It will make the work simpler, easier, and more efficient for teacher, and help in boosting the creative thinking of our children.
Absolutely, absolutely. So the teachers who use technology well will do great. And the teachers who do not use technology well, or don't understand technology, or have a fixed mindset towards technology, I think they're going to really face the challenge, and they're really going to go out of, I can absolutely say that they're going to go out of the the trade of teaching. Absolutely.
Agreed, sir, because, you know, today digital edge or digital literacy is something that we all need to possess. Without it, we cannot exist now.
Absolutely, totally, totally.
Yeah, so going ahead, sir, we were just talking about the COVID and the situation. So, sir, this COVID has definitely strengthened the bond between, you know, parental involvement, not the bond between the school and the home. So how do you think that we schools can put an effort in strengthening this linkage of school parent, which somewhere was not up to that mark before COVID?
Okay. So, you know, I'm a, when you talk about the parent and school connection, I'm a fan of the work of Paulo Freire. He, in his book, Pedagogy of the Oppressed, he talks about a term called dialogue. And he really beautifully defines what actually he means by the word dialogue, what actually is a true dialogue in his terms. And I feel that this connection between parents and students, what we really require is to dialogue, and dialogue well. When he talks about dialogue, dialogue is one thing that is very, very important to strengthen this bond of the school and the parent. See, I'm a firm believer that no parent wants anything bad for their child, and no school wants anything bad for the child, right? Because the child is a common thing for both of them, and both of them want good for the children. So there is nothing that can actually go wrong but miscommunication. So a lot of times what happens, a step a school takes, the parent misinterpret it or do not understand it. Sometimes, some parents misunderstand something and just bubble it, you know, out of proportion, and others don't even understand it but just join that, right? So I think that it is very, very important that this dialogue is maintained. Schools regularly communicate with parents about what is it that they are wanting to achieve, what is it that they are trying to do, it is really, really important that there's an open communication between the parent body and the school, and there's a regular feedback mechanism which allows the school to really reflect on the kind of things that they're doing. So I think it's the parents have to, the school has to take the parent on its side. The school has to understand that what is it that the parent wants. The parents have to understand what is it that the school wants, and it's a it's a handshake. It can only work in a handshake. So it's really, really important that there's regular communication. We use as a school, you should one should always use a particular agenda, and the communication has to be regular and by using various medias. So a lot of times when I talk about communication or dialogue, it's always looked at that, okay, we are going to have a session. We are going to have a session, just make your maybe, right now we are going to have a virtual session with the parents. But we've got to look beyond it. The communication is not just having a virtual session. Communication is also our emails. Communication is also small videos that we can send on WhatsApp. Communication is also sending out a small poster about something that the school is doing, educating the parent community about, if there's a new initiative the school is taking, you're educating the parent community through a poster that why that initiative and what will the children benefit from it. So I think, we've got to really strengthen the communication between the school and the parents, and we've got to look at a communication as a multifaceted thing rather than just humne saal mein teen baar ya char baar PTM kar liya hai, ek baar parent orientation kar liya and that's it. I think we've got to look at it way beyond that, and we've got to utilize every opportunity to communicate well with the parent body. I think that is very, very important. And good schools have done it far, far before the pandemic as well, I totally believe that good communication is the key to a strong relationship here.
So I think totally agree with this, because a small gesture taken by the My Child School, sending a personalized video for my daughter's birthday, make me feel so special that, school cares so much about it. And, taking care of the small, small needs of children and informing parents, okay, pandemic's there, this is what you're supposed to do. So definitely a big strategy step by the school that can be taken is to keep a regular open line of communication. And this is what is all needed to strengthen this bond.
Yes, regular open line of communication plus using various, I think I would reiterate this because this is, I think, the most important thing that, you have to make sure that you use various medias of communication. Right now with the technology, it's really, really important to do that, because when you have a virtual session, right? So maybe, in a class of 100 students, maybe 40 children's parents could not attend. So you've got to break the same orientation into smaller videos or into an email, into poster, and send it out to them at regular intervals so that someone who missed out also can look at that poster or a small video and get at least a gist of what the school is trying to communicate. I think that is very, very important.
Absolutely, sir. So, sir, now, sir, going ahead, I purposely didn't talk about any of your achievements in the introduction, sir, because it would be good to know from you. You have a long journey of studying into various universities. So what are the achievements or accomplishments, I would say, that make you feel proud?
So there've been various, recognitions, but, I if you would say that, okay, what is one of them that would, make me really proud of what I am today? I would say that, when I got into school administration, I was more of an administrator. I never got into academics into such detail. And over the years, I felt that I did not get a lot of my answers. I was struggling with improving the quality of education in the school. I always failed to get my answers. Okay, that this should be done. And we always were you know, look a step back, okay, at what needs to be done further, right? So I think that urge really made me to move from being into core administration to actually being a learner and, you know, moving into the academic side of things, understanding, having a more detailed understanding of the school. And when I made that shift, of being a learner and getting into academics alongside the administration that I was involved with, I think that was a big achievement for me. And today, you know, I don't get excited by any third party recognitions or, you know, any of that, because you know that's available in plenty today. But you know what really excites me, that at the end of the day, when I get to my bed, if I'm able to list out a couple of things that I learned today, I think that is what really tells me that, okay, I had a good day today, and I, you know, have a good peaceful sleep after that. So I think making sure that, you know, every day is a learning day for me, and every day I learn at least one thing that I did not know before, I think that is one accomplishment that I would love to have every day.
It's so wonderful to know, you know, keeping yourself so humble that you are always open for learning, and this is what you count every night also. So that's really something very different and unique about you, sir. You know, people are like, I actually know a lot, and I can just transfer my learnings and transfer my knowledge. But knowing someone who believes in attaining knowledge and learning more is something really special for me.
Yeah, I think it is important. You know, I think somewhere we've really misunderstood what is the purpose of schooling, what is the purpose of education as well. So I am a core believer that you know, if I ask, I've asked a lot of parents this question, and why do you send your children to school? Kyun bhejte ho aap school? And most of the parents have replied to this by saying that kyunki sab bhejte hain, isliye main bhi bhejta hun. So, so I, you know, really, it's, I think it's time that we really rethink ki hum kyun bhej rahe hain? Why are we sending our children to school? And I think it is this a trait of lifelong learning. I think this is the most important trait that school needs to develop in every child, who is, because once you have this trait, there's no you know, there's no time in your lifetime that you will, you know, really feel bogged down on. You know, you will always, any situation, you will know how to get around it. You might have to struggle a bit, and struggle is really, really important for the learning to happen. So you will definitely have to struggle, but you will eventually find a way around it, and that is what you know, growth mindset is all about. So yes.
Yeah, so very rightly said, and today I truly understood why you call yourself a chief learner. So, sir, on this note, we reach to the very interesting segment of the show, which is called Rapid Fire Round. You yes. have to answer in one word only. Right? So, here goes the first question. Describe your leadership style in one word.
So, I'm a fan of this author, Keith Farazi. And he and I would definitely love to lead without authority. And I think that is a leadership style that I would love to imbibe.
How many years of teaching experience should a principal have?
I would, you know, I wouldn't say that any number of years is necessary, but I think what is really required to be a school principal, the prerequisite to be a school principal, is that, you know, someone should have at least some experience of all the areas of the school. So, you know, you starting from pre-primary till grade 12 should have at least some experience in all of these areas, and also have, some managerial roles within the school. So maybe like an head of department or a coordinator or an activities in charge. So definitely these small little managerial roles really, you know, make you move towards that principal role. Plus, I think the attitude the attitude is key here. For me, I think the attitude is key in a principal, because if someone is a go-getter and is always with a school principal needs to be a positive person. You cannot have, you know, you cannot be using a no, this cannot be done in every sentence that you use. So I think the attitude and some experience. I wouldn't say a number of years, because you can have someone 30 years experience into teaching but still cannot become a good principal, and you can have someone just 3 years into teaching and can be a great principal. So I wouldn't coin that.
So wonderfully answered this question. This has been like a hot topic between us, like how many years of experience and why is teaching necessary? So to get the, you know, understanding of each and every area, because principal's role is varied. He is, you know, involved in each and every aspect of the school. So he needs to have leadership qualities also. He needs to have teaching experience, academic, finance, everything, you know. He need, even at times, he's required to have marketing skills.
Yeah. So to me, I think the key trait to a school principal is attitude. I think that is the most important trait that you should be looking for in a school principal.
Absolutely, sir. Going ahead, do academic marks matter in life?
No, I think as a society, we've got it like totally. We've missed the arrow and it's gone and hit a different target completely. I think we've got to get out of this race of marks. We've got to, you know, be more concerned about what the children are learning. We've got to look at various ways of assessment. The National Education Policy also talks about having different ways of assessment, using portfolios, using more of formative assessment. We're doing a lot of work on that. You know, we've been doing a lot of work on that in our schools, in the way we assess children, especially formatively, and in smaller chunks as well. So I think that is very, very important. We need to, it'll only happen if our higher education institutes do not value marks as much. And I think that change has started. A lot of these deemed universities now, like the Ashoka University and, you know, the Rishi Hood University, and there are various others now. A lot of them are, you know, opening up the doors to taking children on portfolio assessment rather than just, and this year what happened with the 12th board marks, you know, children were assessed on a very random scale that was shared by the CBSE. So it's really, really important that we move out of the marks race and we actually concentrate on learning.
Right, sir. So going ahead, sir, the last question of this segment. Of the two, which is more important, having talent or working hard?
I think having talent is a myth. To me, having talent is a myth. There has not been a single person who's had talent and not worked hard and done wonders. And everybody has had to work hard. And I think that is very, very important. And I think that is where the, the science of the growth and the fixed mindset also comes in. And the research of Dr. Carol Dweck talks about how we can really set up our children for success, and what do we communicate? So what should we communicate with our children so that they can do better? So maybe, you know, if a child did so well in a test and the parent can say that, okay, you're a brilliant child, this was so easy for you, right? So this is something that, you know, if you communicate this, you're actually setting your child up to have a fixed mindset, because next time when he can't do this, he will feel that, achha, main brilliant nahi hu, because main nahi kar sakta. Rather, if the child was able to do the test flawlessly and the parent comes and communicates to the child, so this was so easy for you, I think we should find something more challenging for you. You know, so you see that shift between the communication, the language that the parent is now using. I think that is very, very important, because once we are able to shift this communication language with the child by through the parents and the teachers as well in the classroom, only then we will set up our children for success. Otherwise, we are always telling them, okay, you can do this and you can't do this. We are never telling them, okay, if you work hard, if you change your strategy, you can be good at something. Right. So I think that is really important.
So we have a great leader with us, and which totally stands true on the saying that leaders aren't born, they are made, and the only thing that make them is hard work and nothing else. So this is what even Siddharth sir is. He is a person who has made himself, he has really worked hard for this, and this is what his thoughts also reflect. So sir, we have known you on the professional front. You told us that you are a great sports, you are a sports person, and also you do yoga and meditation. And still, sir, are there any hidden parts which we don't know, that what do you do when you're not working, and what sports or hobbies you're involved, and how do they help you?
I love reading. I love reading, and cooking is also something that I really enjoy. So you can often, you know, on a Sunday afternoon, I would definitely get into the kitchen sometimes, and would love to prepare a meal. So yes, cooking is something that I'm, you know, that really eases me off at times.
So very versatile person we have here. You know, he's very good at sports. He reads a lot. He cooks. He does yoga. He believes himself in keeping fit. And now he is even having a healthy diet plan. So, this was about Siddharth sir's, you know, the personal part. So now going ahead, sir, now we have reached to the last question of the show, which is also called the viewer's choice question. So this is like, you know, sir, something we all know that teaching is a noble profession, but it is not uncommon to hear these days that schools are being run more like, you know, a business. And this argument holds true in case of many private schools across the country. And on the other hand, running schools like a business, won't it improve the quality, you know, quality of education by attracting better talent into the field and enable resources for better infrastructure? I mean, what is wrong if we called it, okay, I am a schoolpreneur and I am also doing a business. I mean, why is it called like business, school ko business bana diya?
Yeah, you know, you need to see that the word business here and the meaning with which it's being associated, you know, the word business is a very neutral word. It doesn't say that acha ye acha hai ya kharab hai, you know, it's a word. It matlab usko humne ek negative word ki tarah soch liya hai, you know, we've with business we've associated undue profiteering and a lot of those mindsets that have accompanied along with it, right? So I think we've got to not look at, when we say school ko business bana diya, we've got to not associate the word business to it, right? See, today why are people not going to government schools? Because the quality isn't there, right? So, and that's where the private schools come in. Okay, so now the private schools charge a fee. The private schools charge a fee, and because of that fee only they can provide that quality of education. If the private schools will not charge that fees, whatever philanthropy is being done, it will never be sustainable. It cannot be sustainable with the number of private schools we have and the way the private schools is supporting the education in India. No sort of philanthropy will be able to support the need that is there currently in the education space. So it's really important to understand that if we are wanting quality, we need to pay for that quality. I'll just give you an example. You know, I visited a lot of schools in Australia, and I saw that the government there spends about 8 lakh rupees per child per year. And in India, I think, if I'm not mistaken, we spend at least, even the best of the private, you know, a private school like ours charges 1/8 of that. And we try to give that sort of quality, you know. So it is, you know, if private schools were profiteering, education wouldn't be the same. There have, I wouldn't say that, you know, there have not been wrong instances in the private education industry. There have been, but that has been very, very limited. You cannot paint the whole town red because of maybe one house that did not do well, right? So we need to, and I think that's really important, because the work that the private education space is doing right now, I think it is unchallengeable, especially in the Indian scenario right now. And if the private schools weren't there, and there would be a big, big gap, and it would be very, very difficult to fill that gap. So we cannot really call it business. Maybe some other word could be is needed there, because the word business is really looked at in a very, very negative sort of a way.
Absolutely. So, you know, business is associated with profits, with money, ultimately. And that is why we call it as a negative word. But, you know, why should you be attracted to this? You know, they can easily do any corporate jobs or start their own something. Why should they come into schools if there is no earnings? Ultimately, we all have to survive.
So there has to be earnings. There has to be earnings, and that's, see, for example, you know, if someone wants to have a job, and if someone is earning that, you know, in an MNC a 50,000 rupee per month paying job, if he has to come into education, he wants something similar. You know, definitely education brings along, it is a noble profession and brings along a lot of respect and other things along with it, right? But for his household to run, and for us to attract that kind of a talent, because we have to provide quality education to children, we need to give him a similar kind of a pay scale. And for that, it's, you know, parents need to pay that money. Otherwise, if private schools wouldn't give that quality, no parent would come to private schools. We would go to government schools, right? And we are not in government schools because we know, everybody knows what's the situation and why people come to private schools, right? So I think that is really important. We can't judge everything with the same screen. You have, I understand that there has been, you know, maybe a couple of institutes that might haven't been very ethical in the past, and that has really had the effect on everybody else. So I think that's really important, that you've got to look at everybody with a different screen, and you cannot have the same glasses for everybody.
Right, sir. Very nicely said here, sir. So, sir, on this note, we would end the session here. It was really, really wonderful to have you, to share knowledge with you, to understand your vision, and also we got to know what it takes to be a great leader. Yes. So we are very privileged today here to have Mr. Siddharth Rajgiriya with us, and I'm sure my viewers are going to get a lot of insights from this session. So thank you so much, sir, for your time, and we are truly privileged to have you.
Thank you. Thank you, Seema ji. It was great to be here. Thank you.